This is the word of God, and it's a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, and we thank you for the comforting words of this psalm, the promise that you are with your people, that you feed them, that you nurture them, that you care for them as their shepherd. We thank you for Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, who laid down his life for the sheep. We thank you that we can gather here together this morning and worship because of the work that our great shepherd did for us. So God, be with us in our worship. Work in our minds, work in our hearts. Give us voice to praise you. Lord, use your word to speak to us where we are, that we might believe, and believing might commit, and being committed might obey and glorify you in our lives. Lord, I pray that you would do your work in this place this morning. For God, we need you as our shepherd. We don't come as those who are able in and of ourselves to take care of our own lives. God, we need you. And we need you here this morning, and we rejoice in the fact that you have promised in your word that you will be God to your people, that you will be the God who shepherds us. Lord, I also lift up the Valdezes as they work this morning in their very different area than our own. I pray that you would bless them, and I pray that the gospel would do great work there, and that many of the Navajo would come to Christ, and that there would be great rejoicing in that place this Lord's Day too. May you be glorified, for you are a worthy God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing.
Oh, the please draw near and bless your name.
Thank you.
life, and the dark must flee the breaking day. By your light I see the glory of my King. Beholding him, I will be changed. Spirit of God, breathe on me now. Source of life, come revive my weary heart.
You are.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, dear Lord. We thank you for the rain, the freshness of spring, dear Lord. We thank you that you are a wonderful, merciful Savior. Lord, we thank you that you're there for us at all times, not just when we search for you, but always. Pray you'll be with this service. Be with the pastor as he brings the message. Dear Lord, I pray you'll just our lives each and every day. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I did realize there was something else I forgot to announce when I mentioned Vacation Bible School. We have workers. We'll take more. And if you look in your bulletin, there are worker meetings that you're more than welcome to come to if you just wonder what working at Bible school might be like. And if you signed up, you need to come to. One of the most popular church hymns we sang when I was a boy growing up in church was "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." Of course, it was often the closing or the invitation hymn, hoping that people indeed would decide to follow Jesus as they sang it. You likely know it. It's a very, very simple hymn. If I take out most of the repeats, I'll just share all the words with you. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. Now that is a song that is quite clearly about a commitment to follow Jesus. I'm going to follow Jesus without wavering, even if I have to do it alone, give up everything this world has to offer, even if it costs me my life, I will follow the crucified Christ. That's what you sing when you sing that song. I have decided to follow Jesus. Surely the author, who, by the way, we don't know, it's an anonymous song, he had in mind, though I think, Jesus' command from the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus called to the crowd, there was a crowd with his disciples, Jesus called out to them and he said to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. So I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. That's what the call is. It's a command we all need to take to heart, even if we have no ability to write songs. Following Jesus really is an all or nothing thing. And this morning we're going to look at one of the events that took place that first day, right after Christ rose from the dead. Events on that very same day. And we're going to see how Jesus really leads us to follow him. I mean, if we're going to be that committed to following him, we need to understand about following him. And Jesus helps us, he motivates us, encourages us, instructs us in very specific ways on how to follow him. And that's what we're going to look at this morning from John chapter 20. I will ask that you stand once more in honor of God's word. I'll be reading from verse 19 of John chapter 20. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed him his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." Father, As we look into your word this morning, it is our desire that we would understand why we should follow Jesus, whatever the cost. And God, that will mean that your spirit will need to take this word and do a work in our minds that we would understand what you have to say here. But it also, I believe, means that your spirit will need to be at work in our hearts. God, we need to not only understand, but we need to believe, and we need to have that kind of no turning back commitment. So I pray that your word would do that kind of work in us today for our good and for your glory. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, the words that we're going to look at from Jesus this morning are spoken to 10 of the 12 disciples. Because we're going to find out Thomas isn't there, and we know Judas isn't there. But what Jesus says lines up so well with the words he spoke about his church and the words that are written later by the apostles in the letters that they write to the churches, that we have to see that the words that we're looking at are words for us today just as well. That means they're words of the resurrected Christ to us as his disciples, his followers this morning. Words from Jesus, the risen Jesus, to the church. The risen Christ goes to his disciples in the room where they're hiding in fear, and he leads them, instructs them on how to follow him. And he does that so that we will do the same. The words he speaks to them are for them. They're preserved here for us. So let's consider what Christ does and what he says here in that room this morning. First thing we see the risen Christ do is he comes as the risen Christ who comforts his people. He comes as the risen Christ who comforts his people. That's how he motivates us to follow him. Fearful people aren't good followers. And so Jesus comes and he comforts us. He brings us something precious we really can't find anywhere else. He brings us peace. Now, you may recall how when Jesus came to Mary at the tomb, she was filled with sorrow and grief, and he dealt with her sorrow. He did what it took to minister to her in her sorrow. Now he comes to these men in the upper room, and they are filled instead with fear. They're afraid of the Jews. And so he comes and he deals with their fear. The resurrected Christ comes to his people when all they have to offer him is sorrow and fear. And he deals with that for them. He deals with their sorrow. He comes and he offers himself, really, in both cases, as the cure for that problem. In the disciples' case here, Jesus reveals to them their need to keep following him by dealing with their fear and bringing them peace. He brings them peace. I mean, really, why would we follow anyone else if only Jesus can bring us peace? I mean, seriously, in this world, I don't think it's a stretch to say we're seeking peace. Jesus offers peace. Look what it says. It says, the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples are glad when they see the Lord. And again he says, peace be with you. They're afraid. They're afraid of the Jews who took Jesus to Pilate and had him crucified. They're afraid those same Jews will now go for Jesus' crew, get them put to death just like they did Jesus. I mean, they know, right, who these guys are, because remember, in the courtyard as Jesus is being tried, people just keep coming up to Peter saying, hey, you're one of his followers, aren't you? They are recognized by their face as followers of Jesus. And knowing that their lives are in danger, these disciples, including empty tomb visiting Peter and John, they're all there, locked in a room, overwhelmed with fear. And we're tempted to mock their fear, aren't we? Why don't they trust in Jesus? But the reality is, very few of us have known that kind of situation where we actually feared for our lives with good reason, especially not from the fact that the government or the leaders of our culture were coming to kill us. They were quite reasonable. I mean, in a way, it's like a church gathered hiding because someone's just killed their pastor. We've not been in that situation, and I really hope we never get there. Right? But these men were afraid. And by worldly standards, they had every right to be afraid. Thing is, being isolated by fear is something I think we can all understand, even though we've never been in their shoes. And I'm not just talking about COVID lockdowns or government orders here. We don't spend time with others because we're afraid we're not smart enough, cool enough, or eloquent enough to hang out with certain people. We don't talk about spiritual matters with one another because we're afraid that if we share our spiritual struggles with other people, they think we aren't good Christians like they are. I mean, seriously, how often do we ever share spiritual struggles with each other? And the only reason is we're afraid. We don't speak to our neighbors about Jesus because we don't want them to think they live next door to some religious weirdo. We're afraid they'll think wrongly of us. We know what it's like to be isolated by fear. Even though we don't know the fear the disciples knew, we know fear. So let's see what Jesus has to say to fearful disciples. Twice he says it. He bookends that little section right there with these words, "Peace be with you." Now that was a very common greeting in Jesus' day, but it was not so common when it's spoken by a man who had been executed and buried a few days before. When he says, "Peace be with you," the words mean something a little different, don't they? It's also not so common when spoken by a man who still had the marks of crucifixion in his hand and the spear wound in his side. That kind of lends a little validity to the fact that he can offer you peace in the time of turmoil. It's also not so common when spoken by a man who seems to have just passed through the walls or a locked door to get there to talk to you. Maybe he's got something going that you don't understand. It's also not so common when spoken by a man that you had believed to be the Messiah, the one who gave a promise to you back in chapter 14, verse 27 of John, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you, not as the world gives you do I give you. Let not your hearts be troubled, nor let them be afraid." There he is now. Having said that, having gone to the cross and died, having risen again, now he stands in the middle of the room, obviously the crucified Christ and the risen Christ, saying, "Peace be with you." Their fear was built around his death. His living presence is the source of their peace. It isn't just that he says, "Peace be with you." He stands there as the one who can give it to you. That's why he shows them the scars. Think about it. Their problem was fear. And the solution is the crucified and risen Jesus. So he says, "Hey, have a look. Here's where the nails went through. Here's where the spear went in. Peace comes through the gospel of a crucified Christ." Because he told them that he would die for them. But it's not just through a crucified Christ. It's through a crucified Christ who defeated sin, death, and the grave, rose again, and stands there as the risen Christ. And because he's both the crucified and the risen Christ, that means his peacemaking mission on the cross was a success, and he can walk into that room and say, "I got some peace to give to you." And it means something. He is the source of peace. And that's what they found, because look at what it says. They began in fear. And when they see it's Jesus and he says peace, they were glad when they saw the Lord. Fear and glad are not the same thing. They are filled with gladness because they are in the presence of Jesus and they can be confident in him. Fear is replaced with joy. The risen Christ is the Lord who comforts His people. And whatever fear is keeping you from fully following Jesus today, whatever is holding you back, causing you to turn back, we might even say, keeping you from carrying your cross after Him, whatever fear is hindering you in the call to follow Jesus today, the crucified and risen Lord says, "Peace be with you." He is still alive today. Just as alive as He was in that room on that day, He lives. And He says, "Peace be with you." He called you to follow Him in the first place, and now He comes to you and says, "You can have peace." So the risen Christ comforts His people, and the risen Christ indwells His people. The risen Christ is the Lord who indwells His people. Jesus doesn't just offer them peace. He is there. He is peace to them in the room with them there. But I am sure some of them still remember something else He said back in chapter 14. That was the chapter where He kept talking to them about the fact that He was going to return to His Father. That He was going to go do this work and return to His Father. And they were really upset when He said that in chapter 14, that He was going to return to His Father. Well, what must they think now that He has died on the cross, risen again from the grave, is standing there offering them peace? I wonder if they're not thinking, is it about time? And He's actually going to go back to the Father. Chapter 20, verse 18 said that Mary told the disciples what Jesus said to her at the tomb. And what did Jesus say to her at the tomb? He said, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." I imagine if they heard those words from Mary, they thought even if Jesus rose from the dead, He was never going to come see them again. So when He shows up, it must just be on the way. On the way. So maybe their gladness was tempered a little bit by the fact that, well, yeah, you bring me peace, Jesus, but you're going to leave. You're present and I have peace in you, but what about when you go? That's why verse 22 is there. He breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now, we might be confused here because we say this isn't Pentecost. This isn't Acts chapter 2. How can He breathe the Holy Spirit on them and then the Holy Spirit come again in Acts chapter 2? Was it here? Was it there? Well, great preachers and teachers of the Bible have disagreed on how to understand this. I have one commentary that offers the seven major opinions as to what happened of it there. Now, honestly, a lot of those seven major opinions say, well, the Bible's not the Bible, so we can say whatever we want. But I think if we look a little closer at what John actually wrote here, we can work this out. First of all, even though all of our English translations say Jesus breathed, a better translation of this Greek word would say Jesus blew on them. It's blue. I mean, there is a word for breathe that just isn't the word we have here. It's the blue on them. It's not used anywhere else in the New Testament, this word. But in the Greek translation of the Old Testament, it shows up a few times, especially in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, where God blows into the nostrils of man the breath of life. It also shows up in Ezekiel 37, where Ezekiel's there and there's a valley of dry bones. And God says to Ezekiel, Ezekiel, you call on the wind to blow life into these dry bones, and these dry bones will live. What Jesus is doing is He is blowing the Holy Spirit of life into these men. Into these men in the upper room. They are receiving the Holy Spirit, not just a promise, but it is the new life of the new covenant humanity that is being blown into them there in this room. They will receive the Holy Spirit in a different way at Pentecost. And there's no conflict with the fact that the Holy Spirit is blown here and the Holy Spirit comes to them at Pentecost. The only reason we see a conflict is too often we look at the Holy Spirit as a commodity, not a person of the Godhead. I've got the Holy Spirit much like I've got a Subaru. Right? You've got it or you don't got it. And even when we say indwell, there's this sense that there's now a little box in me that's got a little Holy Spirit in it. This is the Spirit of God. When we limit the Holy Spirit to something less than the divine third person of the Trinity, we come up with a problem in this package because our Holy Spirit only comes in a box. And if you get the box once, you can't get the box again. But when we understand that He is God and He is a person of the Trinity and He is interacting with people, we understand there's really no problem between John 20 and Acts chapter 2. That the breathing of life into the dry bones of these fearful apostles in John 20 and the gift of the Holy Spirit that results in tongues for mission in Acts chapter 2, we're okay with both of them. They're in our Bible, so we had to be anyway. Right? Okay, Jesus blows on them, I'm sorry, and He says, receive the Holy Spirit. And He had promised back again in chapter 14. He said, I will not leave you orphans. I will send the Holy Spirit to you. And so we need to take heart in this because the same Holy Spirit that comes to these disciples there comes to us. We don't meet Jesus in the flesh and have Jesus actually work up some breath from His resurrected lungs out His resurrected mouth on us. But we receive the Holy Spirit. 1 Peter 1:2 says that the scattered saints of Asia Minor are sanctified by the Spirit. The Spirit comes to them, sets them apart for Christ. 1 John 4:13 tells us, by this we know that we abide in Him and He in us because He has given us of His Spirit. The Spirit of God does dwell within us. So the risen Christ indwells His people. He doesn't just come to comfort them. The risen Christ in the Spirit of Christ comes and dwells with His people. The one named the Comforter dwells in you if you are in Christ by faith. The one who comes and gives new life to dead people, people who are dead in their trespasses and sins, breathes new life into them, has breathed new life into you if you are in Christ by faith. The one who changes fearful saints into courageous missionaries, like these guys in that room, is the same Spirit that has come to you. Hey, let that sink in. Don't just think, well, I can't have the peace they had because they saw Jesus. You have the very Spirit of God indwelling you as a follower of Jesus. The very Spirit of Christ, there is only one God, is indwelling you. So all the comfort that is available to them in that room as the risen Christ stand there is available to you. All the peace is available to you. In a world filled with turmoil, you can have peace. In a world filled with anger, you can have courage. You don't have to let the news eat your lunch every day. Because it will. It will. You know, Russia masses thousands and thousands of troops at the border of Ukraine. That should scare you if you've got a mind. Another Asian country is just in turmoil, tearing itself to pieces because the military took over the government. Well, that's gone bad for us in the past. There's all kinds of reasons, according to the world, for you to be afraid or angry right now. But you have the Holy Spirit of God, and you don't need to be either one. You can have peace no matter what, because God is with you. And that's the promise Jesus brings to them, to us, there in that room. So the risen Christ comforts His people. The risen Christ indwells His people. We also see the risen Christ sends His people. The risen Christ is the Lord who sends His people. See that in verses 21 to 23. He brings them peace, which they needed. I mean, they're not going to be able to do anything but stay in that holy little huddle in that upper room and shake together if He doesn't bring them peace. But He brings them peace. And it's the peace of gospel victory. It's victory in Jesus kind of peace they have in the upper room. And then Jesus, he ensures them that he's never going to leave them because he breathes and says, receive the Holy Spirit. He doesn't say taste or sample the Holy Spirit. It's not the Holy Spirit buffet. They get the Holy Spirit. And then after having comforted them and indwelt them, he sends them out with a peacemaking gospel. Here it is for you guys, and it's all good. Now get out there and give it to other people too. That's what he does. It says, the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord, and the Lord Jesus said to them, again, peace be with you. And then he said, as the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. They were gathered in fear. Jesus brings them peace. He gives them the Spirit, and then he says, get out of here. He says, go, scatter. He sends them. He says, just like the Father sent me. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. The Father sent him so that folks who believe in Jesus can have eternal life. Just like the Father sent his Son, Jesus sends his followers. Go out and seek to save that which is lost. Jesus the Son sends his followers to bring the good news of a salvation that will bring peace to fearful people. Take that news into a world of people who are lost. The mission of Christ is your mission, church. Jesus doesn't say, I've done my bit, now do your bit. He says, I have a mission, you're my people, let's go. Receive the Holy Spirit, peace be with you, go. Go. This is really the great commission in the Gospel of John, the mission of the body of Christ. And we know what he's sending them to do because he says, I am sending you, and breathes on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. And then he says, with words that ought to little set you back a little bit if you actually read them, he says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. I mean, that's kind of like a boom statement. I would drop the mic, but well, it's, if I drop this one, it just scares everybody. So, but if you forgive the sins of any, they're forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness, it is withheld. They are to receive the Spirit, be indwelt by the Almighty Spirit of the Most Holy God and filled with the Spirit. They are to go with the authority of Christ to a lost and dying world. They are to proclaim good news about the forgiveness of sins, and they can be completely sure of this. When you say to someone, them, when they say it, when you say it, it's true, both of them, if you say, if you repent and believe in Jesus Christ, you will be forgiven. Everyone who repents and believes in Jesus Christ will be forgiven. You can go out with authority and say that. It's no maybes. No, well, it might work for you. It's if you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and repent of your sins, you will be forgiven. You have that authority to go out and say that. Nobody will ever repent and turn to Jesus and go away without their guilt dealt with. Nobody. And when you go out and say, or when they go out and say, if you reject Jesus, you will die in your sins and you will suffer for them. You go out with the authority to say that, knowing that everyone who rejects Jesus will remain unforgiven and face eternity and suffering. You have the authority to say that. Nobody will ever reject Jesus and find themselves in heaven. The Lord who comforts through the presence of the Holy Spirit is the Lord who authorizes by that same presence you to go and offer the gospel good news to people. You realize it's not really evangelism unless it's good newsing, because that's what the word evangelize means, good heralding, good messaging, or good newsing. And it's really not good news to anyone unless you can say, I am offering you this good news, and it really is good news for you if you will believe. And that's what Jesus is telling them right there, that they can go out and they can really say, if you will believe and you will trust and you will follow Jesus, you will be saved, and know it is absolutely true every time they say it. Because they're not going to go out and just, hi, my name's Peter, and I want to forgive your sins today. They get it. I mean, we see the message they proclaim. They understand what this message is. The Lord who comforts through the presence of the Holy Spirit is the same one that authorizes us to go and tells us to go. So as we go, we can know we have the authority to make that offer. The risen Christ is the Lord who sends his authorized people, but he sends them. He doesn't just authorize them and say, well, now you can, you know, put that on your resume. He says, go do something with it. Just think about that. I think we can all agree that Billy Graham was a committed evangelist, right? I mean, he was committed to this evangelism thing. A man who knew he was sent to bring the message of peace of Christ to a lost and dying world. Well, I'm going to read you something Billy Graham wrote in Christianity Today back in 1956. He says this, in 1949, I had been having a great many doubts concerning the Bible. I thought I saw apparent contradictions in Scripture, some things I could not reconcile with my restricted concept of God. When I stood up to preach, the authoritative note so characteristic of all great preachers of the past was lacking. Like hundreds of other young seminary students, I was waging the intellectual battle of my life. The outcome could certainly affect my future ministry. He goes on and says, in August of that year, I had been invited to Forest Home Presbyterian Conference Center high in the mountains outside of Los Angeles. I remember walking down a trail, tramping into the woods and almost wrestling with God. I dueled with my doubts and my soul seemed to be caught in the crossfire. Finally, in desperation, I surrendered my will to the living God revealed in Scripture. I knelt before the open Bible and said, Lord, many things in this book I do not understand, but thou hast said, the just shall live by faith. All I have received from thee I have taken by faith, here and now by faith. I accept the Bible as thy word. I take it all. I take it without reservations. Where there are things I cannot understand, I will reserve judgment until I receive more light. If this pleases thee, give me authority as I proclaim thy word, and through that authority, convict me of sin and turn sinners to the Savior. Within 6 weeks, he continues writing, within 6 weeks we started our Los Angeles crusade, which is now history. And I'll just step aside and say, yeah, it's history. I mean, read about the Los Angeles crusade. This is when Billy Graham became Billy Graham. He says, during that crusade, I discovered the secret that changed my ministry. I stopped trying to prove that the Bible was true. I had settled in my own mind that it was, and this faith was conveyed to the audience. Over and over again, I found myself saying, the Bible says. If you ever listened to Billy Graham, you know what it sounds. You heard Billy Graham say that as I said it, didn't you? I felt as though I were merely a voice through which the Holy Spirit was speaking. And he says this, he says, authority created faith, faith generated response, and hundreds of people were impelled to come to Christ. A crusade scheduled for 3 weeks lengthened to 8 weeks with hundreds of thousands of people in attendance. The people were not coming to hear a great oratory, nor were they interested merely in my ideas. I found they were desperately hungry to hear what God had to say through his holy word. Do you see what happened there? Billy Graham believed, when he believed the word of God, he came to believe. And that's what he said. I had the authority to go out and say, if you will trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. And when I believed, I spoke with that authority that it would always be true. It happened. It happened. Once he decided he didn't need to prove the Bible anymore, but just needed to proclaim the good news, once he realized he could really offer forgiveness of sins through Christ, that he had been authorized by the Spirit to make that offer, he became the Billy Graham that I used to watch about every 3 weeks or so on television. Now, none of us, at least likely none of us for that matter, will ever have the same kind of ministry as Billy Graham. Quite honestly, no one, again, will ever have the same kind of ministry as Billy Graham. It's not the same world. But even so, if you are a Christian this morning, then you are a follower of Christ, and you are authorized to make that offer on behalf of God. You are authorized to go tell people that if they'll turn from their sin and in faith come to Jesus, they will be rescued from the wrath of God forever. You can make that offer and know it'll work. You can know the same God who called you to follow Him and it brought you the forgiveness of sins and brought you peace with Christ sends you now into the world. So He sends us. The risen Christ goes to His disciples in the room where they're hiding in fear and motivates, directs, and empowers their commitment to follow Him. He's the risen Christ who comforts His people, who indwells His people, and who sends His people. Now, I believe that most of us in this room would claim to be a Christian. That means the message brought to you by the risen Christ, the one is the same one He brought to these cowering disciples there in that room. The same Jesus who called you to follow Him in the first place comes to you and brings you the gift of peace. Brings you the gift of peace. And I think the order really matters here. I think until you understand that you can have that peace and you really take a hold of that peace, it's going to be hard for you to go. So let's start there. That peace is yours. Following Jesus will not be easy. We were never promised comfort and ease in following Jesus. Following Jesus will not be popular. Jesus said, they hated me, they'll hate you. Following Jesus will not bring about peaceful circumstances. It's not like because you have this authority, suddenly they'll be like, I don't know, shiny rainbows following you and unicorns leaping in front of you as you go to share the gospel or something. I don't know if that would be very peaceful either. But the point is that Jesus offers you gospel peace. He offers you Himself and the knowledge that He really did pay the price for your sins. The guilt and shame that you knew in your sins is not yours anymore. And you can be at peace with God every moment of every day. That peace is yours. The rocky way of life in this world can be a way of peace for you. And that same Jesus who called you to follow Him, though, and brings you the gift of peace, He dwells with you and He sends you into the world with the gospel that has the power to save sinners. He offers you peace, but it's not a peace of unemployment. It is a peace of a vocation. You're given a job to do. He sends us, tells us to join Him on His mission. Now, where does He send us? Where is He sending you this morning? Well, he sends you wherever there are people who don't know the good news that they can have peace in Jesus Christ. That's where He's sending you. Maybe He's sending you to Pittsburgh in July. There are groups of people there in Pittsburgh starting churches, reaching out to groups of people who really have never heard the message of Jesus Christ in the city of Pittsburgh. And you can go and help them. We're just doing easy stuff, packing backpacks, feeding people, going out to the homeless and stuff, so that the message can go with us and be heard. Maybe He's sending you to invite children to Bible school. Maybe there's a neighbor or a family with children near you that you've really never struck up a conversation with. Here's an easy way to do that. Our church has Bible school coming up for children all the way up through sixth grade, right? All the way up through sixth grade. And I would love for your children to come. As a matter of fact, I would be happy to drive them. And if you want to come and just sit and see what goes on the first day, we'd love for you to come do that too. So maybe He's sending you to invite children to Bible school. Maybe He's sending you to your own family members. Just because they grew up with you and you heard and understood the gospel and were saved doesn't mean they really heard and understood the gospel. Maybe he's sending you to your family members. Maybe he's sending you across your yard or across the street to that hard to deal with neighbor who has no peace because he doesn't know Christ. This could almost be a selfish mission. What if that neighbor's hard to deal with because he has no peace? And you can offer him the peace of Jesus Christ. Maybe he's sending you to join with the North American Mission Board in a church plant somewhere. Maybe he is. Maybe he's putting that on your heart saying, look, I really want to do that. I want to get with one of these people. I'm willing to pack up my family and move to wherever they need to start a church because there's lost people. I mean, really understand this. We are starting churches in our cities, in areas that may as well be foreign countries as far as the gospel is considered. And maybe that's the missionary call God is placing on your heart. If it is, I'll help you figure out how to make it happen. Or maybe he's sending you to join with the International Mission Board in reaching an unreached people group somewhere. Maybe a short term, maybe for a couple months, maybe for the rest of your life. You realize missionaries who go to international mission fields come from churches like ours. They don't all just come from big churches. There's not like the missionary-making church and the not missionary-making church. So maybe God is sending you. But wherever it is, whether it's one of those places or one of those places your pastor couldn't think of as he was writing his sermon, maybe it's time this morning that you say, Christ, I understand you are sending me. I understand this is where you are sending me. I understand you have given me the Spirit and you have given me the authority to take the gospel here. I will go. Maybe it is time to say, I have decided to follow Jesus. The cross before me, the world behind me, I have decided to follow Jesus. My cross I'll carry till I see Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Brothers and sisters, I want to confess to you that I believe we have been at ease in Zion, and as we, I include I. We have grown up and lived in a nation where we've been so blessed that we could actually be lazy Christians. That we could just come to church on Sunday, enough people would come as we started this or that program, that we could keep the numbers up well enough to keep the bills up and start new programs because the money was coming in. We could build nice buildings. We could do comfortable church. All we did was change the setting of the upper room and give it air conditioning, heating, and nice seats. But it's time for us to see that he came to us, fearful disciples, and he said to us, I'm giving you my peace. Whatever that world, it looked scary out there, so you stayed in here. You don't need to stay in here anymore. I'm giving you my peace. And I'm giving you my Spirit. You can have me with you at all times, me with you. You don't need to be scared as you go out there because I'm always with you. And he's saying, go. So it's time for us to quit worrying about how we're going to recover the huddle after COVID. And I'm really, as a pastor, tired of seeing articles on that. I am. Here's how we do it. We just do it. Right? It's time for us to quit worrying about that and start saying, look, it's more important that we recognize this world is not the world of ease we lived in. It's a world of conflict where what we need to do to find real joy and real peace is obey that command and go. He sent us. We need to go. So let's make that commitment today. It will be for our good. It will be for our joy. And it will glorify our God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you sent your Son to seek and save the lost. And he came and he died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he rose again. on the third day according to the Scriptures. And God, by His sacrifice, our sins were paid for. And by His resurrection, we are justified. God, I pray that if there's someone here this morning who doesn't know that, can't say that for themselves, I pray that Your Spirit would work in their heart this very morning, that You would convict them of sin and righteousness and judgment and draw them to Your Son today. Lord, for all of us who've been drawn, who have come to Christ in faith, I pray, first of all, that we would know that peace, that we would not let the fear of this world win anymore, that we would recognize the peace that is ours in Christ and live in light of that peace. And I pray that in the power and the authority of Your Holy Spirit dwelling in us, that we would be faithful to go, full of peace and not fear, that we would go, and that You would use us to lead others to know Jesus and to know His peace. God, please use us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as Wes comes and he leads us in our closing hymn, what I'm going to ask you to do is consider where you stand in your commitment to following Jesus Christ. And I would ask you to do that specifically. I mean, we can always, every Sunday, come in and say, I am saved by grace. That is wonderful. And I'm glad about that. And so I'm going to go out with more peace. I hope that happens to you every Lord's Day. I really do. But I hope that we don't just stop there. I hope that on the Lord's Day we also say, you know what? Here's where I've not been following Jesus in my walk, and I really need to. So I'm going to ask you to consider that this morning as we sing. And if you need to make a commitment and you want us to pray for you in that commitment, come and share. If you want to join this church, you want to make a commitment to this local body and say, I want to be on that mission with you all, this would be a good day to do that. But whatever you do, please deal with Jesus' command, His sending of you to go. Please stand.
Okay, first of all, before I talk about Abigail, seriously, we are so glad that God gave poets to the church. And say, as the death dew lies cold upon my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Seriously, that is so good. Abigail has come this morning. A few weeks ago, after Sunday school, she spent some time speaking with her Sunday school teacher about wanting to be sure. She knew Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior, and she has that assurance. She's talked to the Lord about it, and talked to others about it. Now Abigail wants to be baptized. That was a pretty weak amen for something that wonderful. I expect you to just share that with her, that you are excited about this, because Abigail is declaring publicly, which it isn't always easy for everyone to declare things publicly, and I understand that, that she has decided to follow Jesus. Yeah. And that is good news. Oh, you can go ahead and back. If after Wes leads us in our closing chorus, I'm going to ask Dick Becker if he would close us in prayer. Would you do that?
That Jesus Christ is Lord.